This is Free Speech, a Suffolk Libraries podcast series which celebrates libraries' rebellious history as spaces for free learning and freedom of speech. Each episode, we invite an artist or professional we admire to take the mic. They tell us about their life and work, their triumphs, tribulations, and their hopes and fears. Suffolk Libraries is a charitable organisation which runs the county's library service. We also have a thriving arts programme generously funded by Arts Council England. This is Free Speech. Enjoy the podcast.
Hello, my name is Cad Taylor. I live here in Ipswich in Suffolk. I have a number of different roles currently. I was born in Suffolk, Ipswich Hospital, and I grew up in Tunstall, which is a tiny village. I grew up not even in the village bit, in the end bit towards the forest. So it was a very rural upbringing. I think that definitely influenced future decisions of what I wanted to do and where I wanted to live. My dad's family were very Suffolk. He's traced quite a lot of it back, hundreds of years. And my mum's family are Irish, so my nana came over in the 30s. I went to school in a very small rural school in Ike, which I really enjoyed actually, apart from the school dinners, which I was not always into. The interesting thing I would say about my primary school, even though it was rural, was we had an American airbase in between my house and the primary school, where hundreds and hundreds of people were working and living, and lots of Americans, and the influence was really significant for me. Had American friends and families that lived in my village from different backgrounds, families, black families, kids that had brought different music and styles to our very rural primary school. So I think that was quite interesting and something I feel like I want to explore again and look back on. I went from there to Fylingay High School in Woodbridge. This was a ginormous eye-opener. The school was obviously a huge leap from a rural primary school, so it was huge. So you could suddenly see thousands of other kids, other styles, other backgrounds, other clothing, other influences, which was really exciting to me. The house I lived in was... it wasn't huge, it was quite small, it had a lovely garden, it was on the edge of the forest. We had a really, one of those very nice childhoods where you could get up in the morning if it's a nice day and you'd be gone. I have two older brothers, there was a couple of other kids in our little kind of hamlet, and we'd just be going out and about. I was younger than my brothers, so I was probably the one that was following along. Biking and sledging if it was snow weather, playing lots of nature as well, walking and being out and about. It was definitely rural though. I had no real concept of urban living at all at that time. Later on, I really crave that. So as soon as I can, I kind of try to gravitate to the more urban world, probably because of having such a idyllic but very rural upbringing. I was quite a quiet child. My mum tells me I didn't speak at nursery, but just interestingly quite quiet because I obviously talk quite a lot now. I was very self-contained. I had a little bedroom upstairs and I made my own entertainment. I made little radio shows. I loved drawing and I loved reading at that time very much. Definitely was an artistic family. My mum is a wonderful piano player, learning from a small child, and a violin player as well. And she's just very natural, beautifully natural musician. Both sides of the family are musical, actually, in a very kind of natural grassroots way. The Irish side, I had a granddad, which I unfortunately never met, who was a wonderful poet and raconteur and really full of life and was writing music and fun songs and playing any instrument you could give him across the pubs that he lived near in Ireland. Same on my dad's side, there was lovely, very natural piano players, and I think his great uncle played the clarinet in the Navy. So there was a natural element of music throughout both families, which again definitely flowed into my siblings and my own life and was a really positive influence. musically, my brothers were definitely an influence for me, my first influences, very different in their own interests. My older brother was into things like the Smiths and Carter, USM, and my other brother got into Rolling Stones, Jimi Hendrix, Guns N' Roses, then Nirvana, and that at that period for me was very influential, and I kind of copied everything he liked. Then he got into hip hop and I copied that, and before I was really went off on my own trajectory as well. So yeah, they were definitely big influences. I went to art college when I was 18, and Suffolk College, they did a really good art foundation, which I still recommend people do to this day, where you get the freedom to reject all of the rigid learning that you'd done at GCSE and A level, where I found it quite staid, this idea of these sketchbooks that were very formulaic. And we had lovely tutors that I remember to this day. I see some of them still to this day as well. They really influenced me and excited me to then apply to go to art college. So I went to Brighton for 3 years. So you can see that I went from Tunstall to going to Fylingay High School and being in Woodbridge a lot, to then being in Ipswich for the art college. And at that time, my next biggest influence was a friend who had a shed in Woodbridge where he lived, and we would all spend a lot of time there. And when I was 18, 19, I'd be there a lot, listening to music, sitting outside, hanging out, lighting fires, eating and chilling and talking to people. And I think that time for me was a real influence. Took me on a different musical journey. Going on again then from Woodbridge and Ipswich to Brighton, it was a massive sensory explosion for me, being in the middle of a city that was absolutely rammed full of creative people. In my first week, I was lucky enough to my friend who had the shed introduced me to people he knew in Brighton, which were comedy writers, directors, poets, artists. And I very quickly met a little group who I was younger than them, but I spent a lot of time with them and they really influenced me. And I learned a lot about being a creative person and the freedom it can mean. I had a lot of fun, went to a lot of parties and loads of live gigs. And it was the big injection of urban living that I think I needed at that time. I went to the Car Boot every single weekend of those 3 years in Brighton and bought loads of junk and records. I bought a harmonium once, which sadly has got lost along the way, but that's somewhere somebody's enjoying it, I hope. I studied fine art painting and the course was very free, so I can't emphasize that enough. You were given a studio space and you would kind of see you in 3 years. So it was a matter of self-exploration where we could go off, bring stuff back to the studio. I was a bit of a hoarder. I always have been collecting bits of ephemera, bits of things that might be part of my artwork, or they might be things that would inspire a piece of work as well. I really enjoyed it. But I think now on reflection, the experience of just being in Brighton was equally as influential as being at art college. Primarily my course was painting, which I did a lot of, but I also took photographs, spent time with people talking. I played music quite a lot with people at the time. I joined this free jazz ensemble where you didn't have traditional music. It was like John Cage sort of experimental music. Quite enjoyed that as well. Met a fantastic person called Juan who definitely freed my mind. He was from Colombia. He was really liberating and interesting and wild and quite a physical, big artist, a bit like Julian Schnabel's, this idea of this, his physicality being imparting into his work. And I think he sets fire to the studio twice, actually, over the 3 years, which was hilarious. After university, I did want to stay in Brighton, but it became a bit unfeasible at the time. I didn't have any work, so I came back to Suffolk, and that was weird, and I didn't know if that was the right choice. But there is a massively exciting scene of people that I know here back in Suffolk that are doing really cool things that are non-mainstream, putting on gigs in village halls or projections. They were doing drive-in cinemas. So even though I was freaking out probably by being back in Suffolk, I enjoyed to spend time with this lovely, wild troop of people. I became a learning assistant at Chantry High School for a while, and then I ended up teaching at Leyston High School, which was a massive influence. So I hadn't got a teaching qualification, but they were really stuck for a teacher. And I thought, well, I can do this. So I spent three terms at Leyton High School teaching A-level, GCSE and Key Stage 3. So the A-level students were really only a couple of years younger than me, which was also strange. I think I was 21. I did that again in Ipswich at St Albans. And then I drifted away from that and did a lot of set painting after that, and freelance, a bit of sign writing and set painting and various jobs, met lots of people, joined a youth theatre company. I think I was just about young enough to join that for a couple of years, which I enjoyed. And then I eventually found out there was free radio courses happening at Ipswich Community Radio, at CSV Media in Ipswich. So in 2004, I undertook a radio course with Becky Betts and Dawn Gerber and started a radio show the following year with Ed Barnes, which I did for 3 years, a breakfast show. And then I was in the building. So once I was in CSV, I had no idea what else happened there because I was there so early for the breakfast show. Then I started to look around and started volunteering there on their fantastic road shows they would do right across Suffolk. Then I started teaching one-to-one with a project called Lapwing, working with young people with additional needs and needing additional support, which I very much enjoyed. And it was the community work and the social engagement and the striving for social justice which definitely propelled me on, which I really enjoyed. There was people in the building learning English, there was the radio station, there was youth projects, there was equality movements within the building, there was an internet cafe where you had all types of people coming in. And then I started working on a mental health project. It wasn't a counselling service, it was more of a non-mainstream routes to well-being and mental health and tackling social isolation, I suppose. And I really did enjoy that. I was so massively inspired by my colleagues. So people that run the projects, the people in charge of the building, Bruce and Tonya and Siobhan and Trevor and Gowri and Prachi, these were people that were doing really brilliant work, kind of unsung heroes, I suppose. It was a building I really wanted to be part of and I wanted to do more. We ended up setting up Ipswich Community Media 5 years ago in 2015 with a team of people that had come through CSV and wanted to do something local. We moved to Punch Studios and ISCRI, the Racial Equality Council building, and then we got going. So that's been going for 5 years. We do ESOL, English learning, youth projects, work with youth offending, local schools. We do mental health projects, use the radio. We use recording studios. Myself and Angele Joseph have been running South Street Kids for many years now, a youth project, free Saturday mornings for the kids that are mostly in the Westgate ward of Ipswich. I've learned so much from those children, actually, from those young people who are from Lithuania. They're Roma, they're Portuguese, they're British, they're all over, and they bring so much energy and ideas that I end up getting from them. So we feed each other, I think, with that project. So time gets to December 2018, where I was asked if I would like to apply for a job at the BBC. Initially, I thought I was fine, I'd got work, but then I thought this could actually really give better profile to all of the people that we were working with and the projects locally as well. So in February 2019, I became Communities Manager at BBC Radio Suffolk, where I was able to spend time nurturing relationships with community groups. And we eventually hatched a plan to start a radio show, which started in September. And that was called Belongings, which is still running today. And that's about diverse voices and stories and journeys from all over the world and all over our county, bringing them to the media and also getting people involved in telling their own stories, giving them the platform, which I've enjoyed as well and learnt such a tremendous amount from. What I want to achieve with that role is to normalise the idea of thinking these communities are different, how can we tell their story, and for it just to be normally considered within all media teams to be covering all stories, whereas at the moment it often can feel siloed or there's a ghetto of a community radio show that picks up on those wider stories, that we are all engaged in thinking about how everyone's experiences, though they're not the same, are equally valued, and that we have true equity within the media. It's going to be a fight that we continually work towards and want to change. I maintain my work with Ipswich Community Media, and that's created very positive advantages and obviously some challenges, because I've always been on the front line of trying to fight for those communities, and now within my role at BBC, it's also about reflecting and telling the stories and not necessarily being at the front line of fighting. So I work on that all the time, what that looks like, but it's about finding other people to tell empowering stories and the work that they're doing. Got some really great people on board, like Fanwell Mutumburi from ISKRI, Bex Carrera from Suffolk Refugee Support. I've got to know some of the communities here in Ipswich really quite well. The Portuguese communities, I must say, probably because I spent a lot of time in the Portuguese cafes on Norwich Road, and you get to have a really meaningful connection with people. You're in there every day, you see people change. The Portuguese cafe, the larger one on Norwich Road, has actually been there for 20 years. People probably don't realise that. So this is a very established community and quite significant in the town and across both Suffolk and Norfolk, actually. But I've been particularly interested in the Roma community here. It's purported to say we have the largest Roma community per capita in the country. Many, many families, many thousands of Roma here, predominantly from Romania, from different towns in Romania. And for me, they bring such a rich, diverse culture and traditions, and a really harrowing and heartbreaking story of persecution to constantly having to fight racism throughout their hundreds of years. So I think we could feel very proud as a town and county that we do give the Roma communities a home. And when I'm challenged is when people are very ready to call out the different communities without understanding those challenges. And I think together, working together and building trust is the only way that you're going to get a more cohesive society. I was lucky enough, well, I just took myself out last year to Romania for 4 days because I thought I'd like to go and see where all these people have come from that I've become friends with. So I just bought a ticket and went that next day to the airport and flew out to Bucharest, hired a car, drove about 4.5 hours north and just found a bed and breakfast and then stayed and then drove out to Toflia, which is a community in the Moldova side of Romania where many of our Roma in Ipswich live, and they're a very dedicated community and they've built this huge church in Romania built on the foundation stones of the hard work that they do all over the world. And it's about religion for them as being a real saviour. They've been able to channel that persecution and some of those challenges into, for them, through God and through religion. And I could see that and understand that. Then I went on to a different town, a smaller town, where some of the families that I've got to know really quite well, and I stayed at their house and saw how they lived there and how they're trying to change things for themselves. And I suppose a tension with the younger Roma who want to stay in Ipswich and live here, and their parents and older siblings who want to go home and continue to build and change their life back in Romania. And I'm always interested, really. I find that the Romani Gypsy communities here in the UK and the Roma, Eastern European Roma, present so many stories and rich, strong culture, which I'm just drawn to very much. And I've worked hard to tell those stories over the last year on the radio as well. I'm a really big advocate for Ipswich. It gets a raw deal. And recently, it's been known for some of its art organisations. I still want to fight for the underground art and music scene, which is almost, to some levels, invisible. There's some excellent outsider artists here that are just living on the fringes, doing really great music and great art. We've had so many tremendous music movements from this town over the years. Hardcore, drum and bass, hip hop, metal, Indian folk, such a rich array of music and dance music and club scene and skate scene that I think it can get forgotten. So one of the things I was thinking yesterday on my bike ride was I'd like to do a blue plaque series where we remember those places, like the Ipswich Caribbean Association, which was a rich home to the black communities here, but also to the punk, to the music communities. It was a regular haunt for John Peel, and it's been turned into a car park now, and it's as if it never happened. So I feel, you know, it actually makes me feel quite emotional. I feel that to be able to move on and cohesively, we need to remember our past and honour perhaps even the damage that we did by taking away these big monolithic musical spaces. We've got a rich sound system culture in the town, and we need to give a home to those places. And we're still looking for that significant art centre here in the town. If you ask me what art means to me, I don't separate it from life. Art is everything, and everyone has a right to be a part of art and to make it, and never to be judged and to be encouraged. I'm inspired by so many people, inspired by people that fight for social justice, inspired by musicians and artists, and inspired by family members as well. Advice if I had to give to young people, young creative people, is please don't be hung up by the idea of career. Just to absolutely thoroughly attempt to immerse yourself and be interested in what you're trying to achieve. Just get into it and find other people that are into it, and not to be put off and not to be too influenced by the internet and trying to constantly post the things you're doing. Just get into your thing and do it, and please yourself to begin with, and that will then have traction and will definitely connect with other people as well. Find places where you can be and be safely, which leads me to the conversation of libraries. I've always been a part of any protest that has been about saving libraries, because my gosh, it's this big place in almost every single town that you can go to almost every day, and it's free and it's warm, and we shouldn't judge somebody if they want to just put their head down and have a sleep on a table, because it is this wonderful, equitable, free space, and you can have an academic researching a thesis next to someone who's come in just to get some warmth. And if we ever have any kind of political changes that take that away, be prepared to question why they are doing that, and be prepared to fight for your libraries and fight for these social infrastructure, which aren't going to bring you great profit and they aren't going to bring you big pots of money, but they will bring you good social return, and they will bring you a rich, cultural, kind society. And I suppose that's what I'm interested in.